This is More on the Story, where we pull back the curtain and explore the story behind the headlines. I'm Judith Bishop. Thank you for joining us. Today, we go inside the world of television news. Our guest is Albert T. Primo. He's a broadcast legend who invented Eyewitness News. If you watch every night, you can thank him for creating the format that changed the face of local news. He won awards, generated ratings, and made ABC stations number one. Al Primo started his career in the 1950s when television was in its infancy. He was a reporter, editor, and anchor who rose through the ranks by translating his big ideas into compelling newscasts. Moving from Pittsburgh to Philadelphia and finally New York City, he became one of the most respected news directors of all time and vice president of news at ABC. In a business where leadership counts, Al Primo led the way, tackling every obstacle with determination and imagination. He created a legacy that lives on in newsrooms and living rooms all over America. In his book, Eyewitness Newsman, he wrote, "Stories from behind the scenes are often a lot more interesting than the news we broadcast." We'll hear some of those stories today. Al Primo, welcome to More on the Story.
Happy to be here.
Al, after launching Eyewitness News in other markets, you moved on to WABC, Channel 7 in New York City. That was back in 1968. Our paths never crossed, but I did work there in the 80s, and your legacy certainly did live on. Looking back to the early days of television, it was so different. It was solid, but it was predictable. Viewers saw a middle-aged white guy, a seasoned journalist with a nice head of hair, sitting all alone at an anchor desk, right? He had a voice from nowhere. No frills, no diversity. But you looked at that and you said something's wrong with this picture and you decided to fix it. What was your goal and how did you go about making it happen?
What happened really was when I got hired by ABC to come to work at the newsroom there, it was a very disastrous situation in terms of the impact of the television station to its audience. And I was coming from Philadelphia. I grew up in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I went to Perry High School and I graduated in 1953. And looking for a job in Pittsburgh, I went from the start of the Golden Triangle in Pittsburgh all the way up to the Hill District, stopping at every business location in the town. And on the last day, in the last building, I was going up to the 10th floor to what was called Copper's Company. I got off the elevator on the 10th floor, made a left, went in and said to the receptionist, I'd like to put my application in for a job. And she said, take a seat, young man. And the next thing I know, I was placed with a piece of paper in front of me. And at the top of the paper, it said, Dumont Television Network. And I thought, oh, my God, I've made a terrible mistake, but I better fill this out anyhow. And I did. Well, as it turned out, I got called the next day to come to work as the mailboy in 1953 in August. And I did. And I spent, I thought, the rest of my life there. I went from mailboy to every position that a television station has, from, you know, cameraman to editor to director to assistant, all the way up to assistant news director. But I never got a chance to become the news director because when you start out that low on the totem pole, you know, it's very difficult for your credibility to get the big job. And as it turned out, Westinghouse Broadcasting Company bought this television station, the Dumont television station, which was called WDTV on Channel 3. When Westinghouse bought it, it changed the call letters to KDKA. And Westinghouse was a very regimented company and a lot of forms to fill out and a very aggressive management team. And about 10 years into my tenure there, after being passed over for news director, the station manager called all of us together and said, "We're going to have a visit from corporate, and everybody's got to be on their best behavior and make a really smashing presentation." And the station had just hired its news director, a guy by the name of Dave Kelly, a lovely guy, but he was from the Pittsburgh Press newspaper, never had a day in television in his life. And they had asked me to, you know, work with him and try to bring him along. And at that moment, the manager said, "You're going to handle the presentation, Al." So I did. And I talked about the fact that we were going to get the Philadelphia station and we were all going to move there, and that we were going to have, you know, a bureau in Harrisburg, the state capital, and lots of things like that. Well, at the end of the meeting, this guy comes up to me and says, "Hi, I liked your presentation. I want you to give me a call tomorrow morning." And I did. And as it turns out, he was to become the new general manager of this station in Philadelphia. And he hired me as the news director, which was my very first job. Well, being from Pittsburgh, one of the things that you learn, it's a very highly unionized city. And one of the things that you learn, you never want to make any trouble with the union. So you have to be familiar with all the rules and regulations. So the very first thing I did when I got to Philadelphia was to look at the union contract. And the union contract said everybody who was a member of AFTRA, and everybody in the newsroom, by the way, was a member of AFTRA, the union. The contract read, any member of AFTRA could write, report, and read on the air any story that he has put together. So I called the lawyer in New York, and I said, "Does this mean what I think it means?" And he said, "What did you have in mind?" I said, "Well, I'd like to put some of these people on the air. And we don't have budget for that, of course." But he said, "You have every right to do that. And there's no extra charge because, you know, their base salary takes care of it." So what I did was to bring everybody in the newsroom, you know, into the office one by one to find out what their interests were, what their qualifications were. And we set up what really became the first beat system in television. And one of the guys was made the city hall reporter, another medical reporter, another transportation reporter. And Philadelphia is very close to New Jersey, so we picked one of the reporters to be the New Jersey reporter. And we started having these people do their reports from the field and appearing on the set. Well, it was a tremendous change in what television was, and it was widely accepted. And all of a sudden, the station, I'll be perfectly honest with you, the station, which was an NBC affiliate, had a very strong news operation anyhow, and everybody in the newsroom was quite talented. So this, using the reporters on set and on the camera, lifted it to, you know, even greater heights. The audience really was captured by this new technique. And I spent 3 years there developing this and working out all the pugs, and including there was a very good newswoman by the name of Marcia Rose Shestack. So I put her on the noon news. We started a noon news program. So I put her on the noon news with a guy by the name of Tom Snyder that I had brought with me and hired. And the two of them did a wonderful job and had great ratings. And she was probably one of the first women to be anchoring in a major market. And then I got a tip that there was a young lady by the name of Trudy Haynes, a minority person. She lived in Detroit. And I had her brought in and did an interview with her, showed her around, and hired her, and put her not only in the newsroom and on the set, but on the 11 o'clock program, you know, a major thing. And that worked out very well. Well, all of this started to catch up with me, and I started getting a call from other managers. And one day I got a call from Dick Biesmeyer, who was the general manager of WABC in New York. And so he had asked me to come up and see if I was interested in becoming the news director. Well, I did go up and I did look at the station, and it was a complete disaster. I mean, it was really the worst newsroom that I've ever seen in my life. And he was a very decent guy. And he said, look, we've tried everything here from the all-girl newsroom to a single anchor to double anchors and so forth. And I'd like to see if you would have an interest in coming here. And of course, I did. I had an interest in that. And I did say that, look, things are so bad here that I really need to have, you know, a wide authority to put in anybody I could find that could do the job. And he said, well, you know, you'd have the full responsibility for that. And so that was it. That was in 1968 in September.
What strategies did you use? Tell us some of the stories about hunting through New York, finding strong and relatable reporters that reflected the community. And that, of course, meant adding women and minorities in an era where that wasn't done, except for where you were doing it.
Well, they put me up at the Sheraton Hotel on 60th Street there. And the station was on 66th. So I'd, you know, walk to work every day. And as I walked to work, you know, there were black men, black women, ethnic people, just a whole montage of people that you couldn't see anywhere on television. All you saw on television was, you know, an old white guy sitting there in a very authoritative way, very good guys, you know, all in the form of Walter Cronkite and so forth. And it occurred to me that if I'm going to serve this community, then I'm going to try to see if I can get these kinds of people. Well, I couldn't get anybody to come to work for me. I called Gloria Rojas, you know, who was working over as a writer at CBS, and she, you know, she was very nice and very polite, but she, you know, she couldn't take a chance, and nobody could take a chance. And one of the really hidden values of this event was all the executives at ABC didn't want to be associated with the news department because it was so bad. So I had really full rein in the news department. Nobody was second guessing me. Nobody was asking me questions. And I could pretty much do whatever I wanted. So I set out, being from Westinghouse, you know, there was a whole pool of people from Philadelphia, from Boston, from the coast that I was familiar with. And I decided to get, you know, kind of weekend anchor people or people that were had the ability to speak on camera and to have a presence. And we started hiring them. And I hired Bob Leap from Boston, and John Johnson, and things like that. Well, in the newsroom, ABC, just before I got there, the ABC network, which had an afternoon program called ABC News in the Afternoon that they played after the soap operas, and there was a strike. The company picked a secretary from the news department, the network news department, and put her on to be the anchor of this little 5-minute newscast. And her name was Melba Tolliver, a black woman, beautiful girl, very talented. And she went back to, after the strike was over, she went back, you know, to her desk back at the network. And I called her, you know, I called her and said, how would you like to, you know, make this your career? I've watched you. And she came, and I said, I'm going to put you on the 11 o'clock news. So you got to be ready for that, and everything has got to be exactly right. So we were under the microscope, and everybody that I hired was really exceptional. One of the things that was needed was a Hispanic reporter, And I called Gloria Rojas again and said, you know, you got to come over here. I need you. And she says, well, I can't. But there's a guy by the name of Jerry Rivers, and he's a lawyer in New York, and you should talk to him. And so I called him, and he came into my office, and we had a long discussion. And I said, look, you're helping people one by one, you know, to save their apartments and get their jobs. And you could be helping thousands of people at the same time by coming on to Eyewitness News. And he said that he was interested. And I said, well, you have to do one important thing. Columbia University had a minority training program. And I said, you got to go to that. And you got to finish that and pass all the tests. And then we can put you on. And so he did. He went there and he did a good job. And it was very difficult keeping him, you know, holding him back because he was raring to go every day. But we were able to hold him off until we got all the basics down and he started. And it was very fortunate because the entire Hispanic community just took a great liking to him. And that was another great breakthrough. Well, what happened was all of the networks, CBS, NBC, they started to make fun of us, you know, in terms of Eyewitness News wasn't journalism and, it's not the right way. Even the presidents of these networks, Reuben Frank from NBC and Richard Salant from CBS had made statements about Eyewitness News and was not the journalism that it should be and all that business. And the only people that didn't believe them was the audience. So little by little, inch by inch, we started building brick upon brick this audience. And I'm very proud to say that we did some really good things that were never before done.
Al, you said when you started at Eyewitness News in New York City that the newsroom was a mess. How was it a mess?
Well, it was a mess. It was a mess physically. You know, it was, it was in the old St. Nicholas Arena, which is, if you're old enough to remember this, I'm not. But, you know, it used to be like, a bad version of Madison Square Garden. You know, they had horse events there and so forth. But just the newsroom itself was shabby and unpainted, and the desks were disorganized, and the control room was like a block and a half away, you know. when the guy brought me there and said, okay, I'm bringing you to the newsroom, this is where you're going to work, and this is your office, and all he said, all right, this is your office, this is the newsroom, okay, I got to go now. That was it. And every newsroom that I ever worked in, you know, the control room and the studio was like 2 feet away. This, you had to go outside down 66th Street to get to the studio. So yeah, it was a physical mess. And what's the first thing I did? You know, I had all the desks removed, got the place painted, put pictures up, you know, all of that sort of thing. You know, and I got pictures of Roger and some of the people that we were bringing in. And you want to come to work in a nice, decent place, you know. I mean, I was down to WABC, you know, was not this year, but just before the pandemic, there was an event down there. And, oh, my God, you know, it is unbelievable, fabulous. I mean, the studio, the newsroom, the weather unit and the sports unit, they all have their own big, big, big things. It's unbelievable. It's fabulous.
Al, where did the phrase Eyewitness News come from?
Okay, I'll tell you exactly. When I got to Philadelphia as the news director, my first news director's job, it seemed to me that we needed to have an umbrella number to have an umbrella phrase that characterized our news. And we had a lot of discussion about what should we call our news? Comcast News, Community News, hundreds of names. And then somebody said, you know, back in radio days, back in the 1940s, there's a radio station that did something called Eyewitness News. And that was just a title. And it just hit me like a ton of bricks. I said, Eyewitness News. I mean, that's it. It's perfect. And I said, well, let's see if we can do that. So I called up to our lawyers, and they said, I said, well, the name, tell me about the name Eyewitness News. He said, well, it's, you can't copyright the name because it's already been used. And as a matter of fact, here in Philadelphia, CBS has the right to use Eyewitness as a title because they have a program on the network called Eyewitness to History with Charles Curol, which was an old show that they used once or twice, but never really picked up on it. So, you know, the only thing that you can do is trademark the name to Philadelphia. So that's what we did. We filed the paperwork to call our news, Eyewitness News, in Philadelphia exclusively. And we had to notify CBS, which we did, that we were going to do that. And they had 30 days in which to object and to claim. They just weren't smart enough to figure it out. You know, they didn't, you know, they were, you know, who was Eyewitness knew that it didn't exist, you know, and they had forgotten about, Eyewitness to History. So we got it. We got the title trademarked for the city of Philadelphia. Okay, here's what happened next. 3 years later, I get hired by WABC. What's the first thing I did? The very first thing I did was to take the sign-off news and the sign-on news. These were five-minute news capsules that the stations played at the end of the broadcast day. And I named them Eyewitness News. Eyewitness News at night and Eyewitness News in the morning. And we filed the copyright papers to make Eyewitness News New York trademarked. And we made it. Even though Westinghouse called me up and yelled and screamed and so forth, but we did it. And I'll give you some examples. For example, all the research, and when you get to New York, you have tons of research available to you. You have ratings on your desk the morning that you get there about how the news did the night before. So you could, you know, watch where the show peaked, where there was tune out, all these things that you just make a science of them. And I knew that the audience watched the nightly news maybe 2 days or 3 days a week. Nobody watched it every day. So we decided to do things like special reports. We did three-part series so that we would get the audience to come back. And that was a very strong builder of this audience, getting people to come back on a daily basis.
We're going to take a break. Our guest is Albert T. Primo. He's a broadcast legend who invented Eyewitness News. We'll be back with Al Primo and more on the story.
More on the Story is brought to you by Audible. With over 180,000 audiobook titles from new releases to bestsellers, you can listen to Audible on your computer, iPhone, Android, or Kindle whenever and wherever you want. Plus, just for being a listener of More on the Story, our friends at Audible are giving you a free audiobook of your choice and a 30-day free trial of their service. To get your free audiobook, just go to www.audibletrial.com/more on the story. That's audibletrial.com/more on the story.
We're back with Al Primo, legendary newsman, who's got lots more to tell us on More on the Story. You mentioned Gloria Rojas. I have to interject a personal note. She helped Geraldo get a job. She also helped me get a job, and she's been my very dear friend for over 40 years. When you took over at Channel 7, though, you inherited some people, including an anchor by the name of Roger Grimsby, who was a New York institution.
Good evening. I'm Roger Grimsby. Here now the news. Dog days of summer. Here with a vengeance. Hot weather combined.
And I just want to bet he must have been a little hard to handle. Tell us about your game plan to win him over and get him on board with the concept.
Well, Roger had come to WABC from San Francisco, where he was not only the anchorman, but the news director. But at ABC, he was just the anchorman and not the news director. So he always had a problem with working with a news director, me. he just was the type of guy that always saw the clouds and not the sunshine. You try to work with a person like that. And the very first challenge that we had was, it didn't take me very long to figure out that Roger Grimsby at night alone on this set is not going to be a winning combination. So I knew that I had to get somebody who would ease Roger's stern look and presentation. And to make a long story short, we eventually got Bill Butel.
This is Channel 7 Eyewitness News with Bill Butel.
I'm Bill Butel. Tonight at 11, a prominent New York businessman is found dead in his hotel room. We'll have the story. Haiti has a new president.
Who, as it turns out, had previously worked at the station, but was in London. So I called him in London. I said, would you like to come over and substitute anchor for 2 weeks? And he said, yes, he'd like that. And so I put the two of them together, Roger and Bill, and it was like magic. You know, they respected each other. They played off each other. They read their stories perfectly. And they built a rapport that you could see coming through the set. And one of the things that I learned long ago, way back in Pittsburgh, was people watch television and they want to be not only informed, but they want to get their information from somebody that they like, somebody who they think is part of a family, somebody who's having a good time, somebody who believes in their work. And these two men, Roger and Bill, represented that. And then when we added the team of Geraldo and John Johnson and John Schubeck and Roseanne Scamardella, this team presented itself every night as the news family of New York. And, you know, everybody in New York, not everybody, but most of the people in New York are living in a big, tall skyscraper all alone. They have no family. And we tried to create that family for them and were very successful because many times people would tell me that, that they just made watching Eyewitness News part of their life. And, you know, before dinner, after dinner. And that was really one of the key things that put us over the top. So working with Roger, and answer your question, was not the easiest thing in the world. You know, and by the way, he had to be convinced that putting other people on the set, reporting stories, was not taking away from him, but was adding to his luster and delivery. I said, look, you're the on-the-air news director. You're the man that's bringing these people on. It's not me, you know, so stop worrying about your airtime, you know, just be you. And, they finally bought into that. And there's nothing more convincing to a talent than to get them to see reaction from their audience, you know. So these guys would go to lunch, dinner, and people would come up to them, and all of a sudden they realized, hey, this is something great. So they put their best efforts, and there are little tricks that I said. Like, for example, they both did the 6 and 11 o'clock show. But in order to make sure that they came to work fully prepared, I called my friend at the ABC television network, and I said, look, you guys have all these 5-minute network newscasts. I'd like Roger Grimsby to be the anchor of the 2 o'clock ABC News report, and Bill Butel to be for the anchor for the 3 o'clock. So each of them had to come into work early, fully prepared, and to do a newscast, even if it was on radio. But the trick was to get them in there early enough so that they could start to become prepped for this big effort that we were going to do at 6 and 11 o'clock. And that worked very, very well.
It certainly did. You had so many innovations. You wrote a book about your experiences called Eyewitness Newsman, and in it, you referred to Roger and Bill as sandpaper and satin. And I think that really says it all. You know, they had political opinions. You're in news, you're a political junkie, but they hid them. They were very unlike the anchors that we see today. You mentioned Roger was a little prickly. He was a curmudgeon, so he seemed to dislike everybody, and you couldn't tell how he voted. And Bill was such a consummate foreign correspondent pro that he hid his beliefs. But the times have changed. How do you feel about today's opinion-laced newscasts?
I think that's one of the worst things that has happened to our business and to our industry. And the great violators of this, of course, are the cable networks that have, you know, 24 hours a day to fill. And they've devised these themes to have, you know, one network is the conservative network and the other network's the liberal network. And I just think that it's difficult for people to differentiate between what political angle these people are coming to and from. And we just made it our business to make sure we were straight down the middle in everything that we did. And one of the things that people forget was the television industry had something called the Fairness Doctrine. And the Fairness Doctrine required television stations to show both sides of every story every day. Well, Congress eliminated that fairness doctrine. So you could only present one side or another. And they said, well, you know, the audience is smart enough to know, you know, what's going on. Well, the audience isn't smart enough to know that. They think whatever they're hearing on television is the truth. And it isn't in some of these cases. You know, you have Fox being a super conservative situation. And, you know, their angles and their guests are all believers in the conservative cause, which is fine. But, you know, you can't present yourself as, you know, down the middle, fair and balanced. You're not fair and balanced. You know, you're one-sided. So this has been a very difficult thing for the industry. And I think that the evening newscasts that each of the networks put on are pretty good. You know, they're pretty straight. And I think that they work overtime to be right down the middle, showing both sides of every story. But the cable systems and the others are really a detriment to our industry.
Well, we certainly agree about that. I recently wrote a book called Changing Channels, From Just the Facts to Outrageous Opinions. And getting on the issue of cable news primetime, you know, it's not news. It's the equivalent of talk radio, only with pictures. And those pictures are very deceiving because all the elements scream newscast. You see an anchor behind a news desk with news graphics, talking to the newsmakers of the day, and you think it's news. But I think insightful viewers get the difference. But many, many people think every word that is uttered is fact, and it's not opinion, and it's not fiction. And it is detrimental. So how do we get out of this morass?
Well, that's a very good question. And I think the answer is very difficult to ascertain. I don't know. I wish I had the answer. I really do wish I had the answer to that, because that would really serve the world and the industry very well. I don't know. I think, you know, pictures tell the story, but you got to be sure that the pictures are fair and objective. And that's another thing. You know, you see a lot of violence. Pictures don't lie. When someone's getting beaten on the street, you know, that's a picture. And that's truth. And these are things that body cams and things like that have revolutionized the coverage. And so journalists have to be more responsible than ever. But not only the journalists, but you have to have management insist on fairness and balance from the top all the way to the bottom. And that needs to be enforced in any way possible. Now, the way it works now is, you know, whoever has the ratings is really the institution that makes the money and has the most influence. So the danger is that a lot of people are trying to capitalize on what they anticipate to be, you know, the tone of the land and the times. But as journalists, you know, we have an obligation A journalist is obligated to do both sides of the story and try to insist on doing it that way. It was with this cancellation of the fairness doctrine, and I don't have the exact year in my mind, but it was, you know, a while back. But the genie got out of the bottle when the cable networks came on, and, you know, they just used that opportunity to tell one side rather than the other, because the side that they were trying to deliver to was what they considered to be the majority. And you can find out pretty much who believes in what, you know, through research and so forth. Rupert Murdoch coming along, starting the Fox Network, you know, he's a conservative, he's a known conservative. So he's going to do what he's done with his newspapers and with his broadcasting things overseas in Australia. He's going to bring it here, and it worked there, and it's working here in terms of, you know, the revenue and so forth. And it's frankly very irresponsible in many ways, but they're getting away with it.
When you worked at KYW, that was the home of the Mike Douglas Show, and he had a very brash young producer, a fellow by the name of Roger Ailes. Do you pin it on Roger and Rupert? Were they the downfall of full-time journalism as we knew it?
I'll tell you something. I worked with Roger Ailes. I was the news director of the station when he was like a producer of the Mike Douglas Show. And I'll tell you a little story. The Mike Douglas Show was taped in the same building, and it was before it was live. You know, they would tape a program, and then they would send the videotape of the program to all the stations that carried it. So the program that they did on Monday wouldn't get on the air till a week from Monday. Well, anyhow, on this particular day, Vice President Richard Nixon was coming to town, and Roger Ailes was assigned by the producer of the Douglas Show to meet him at the airport and bring him in. And me, as the news director, I knew he was coming, so I sent a crew out and a reporter. And, you know, we did a bunch of stuff, the plane landing, interview. And when I got back to my desk in the office, you know, the general manager called him. He says, "Reno, Roger Ailes been up here screaming and yelling about you can't use the video of Nixon." I said, "Well, why the hell not? It's a news story." He said, "Well, he's a guest on the Douglas Show, which won't air until a week from now." So we had that battle, and I said, "Well, we're putting it on, you know. I don't care what he says." But try to answer your question. When Roger, you know, he had a pretty big career, you know, with Nixon and Reagan and the Republican Party. You know, that became ingrained in his mind, in his body. And when he had the opportunity to meet up with Rupert Murdoch to start the Fox Network, he brought all of those, you know, he and Rupert locked hands on the first meeting, and the rest is history. So, yeah, he's a culprit in this particular scenario. They have all tried to start their version of competition to the conservative Fox when... And, you know, MSNBC wants to be the liberal voice, and CNN is supposedly trying to, you know, to do it down the middle. But I think they're a little more liberal. But it's a mess, you know, to be perfectly honest with you. All this stuff is going on, and it's, you know, I mean, I have friends, you know, who have Fox on the television all day long, or MSNBC, and I keep telling them, I said, you know, stop watching those networks, for God's sakes, you know, wait till the evening news comes, you know, do it that way.
Stay with us. We're going to take a break. We're chatting with Al Primo, and we'll be back with more on the story.
More on the Story is brought to you by the Hang On to the Dream Foundation, the 501c3 nonprofit organization that helps kids reach their goals in life. To make a tax-deductible donation to the Hang On to the Dream Foundation and make a difference in a young person's life, just go to www.hangontothedream.org. That's hangontothedream.org. And remember, no matter how hard things seem, hang on to the dream.
Welcome back to More on the Story. I'm Judith Bishop. We're here with Al Primo talking about television news, its past, its present, and its future. Al, you're a legend in the business, known as an innovator. Today, if you were running the show, what would your newscast look like?
I'll be perfectly honest with you. When I sit down and watch the newscasts, primarily I'm talking about the evening newscasts, which is what ABC, NBC, and CBS put forth as their, as their best foot forward. And I see a lot of eyewitness news in those endeavors, but I see a lot of mistakes being made. You know, how much sense does it make to have ABC's anchorman come on at the bottom of the hour and take a full minute and a half to tell you the whole day's events, and then go to an outside reporter whose only response is, "Yes, David, you're right." You know, that's not good television. So that has to be fixed.
So what does the alternative look like?
You know, I left ABC because I didn't get, you know, Roon Arledge's job as president of ABC. You know, I said, look, I came to New York. I made New York the number one news. You made me vice president of news of all the ABC stations. Every single one of them is number one. I want the opportunity to do this on the network. Well, it turns out I was a little too young. It just wasn't there. And there was Roon Arledge, you know, with the Olympics and, you know, and ABC Sports behind him. And he wanted, you know, he was being romanced by NBC and everybody else. And they had to give him, you know, reasons to stay at ABC. And one of those reasons was, we'll make you the president of ABC News and Sports. And that was it. So I said, well, look, I'm going to go out and make a Eyewitness News station by station all around the country, which is what I did. I went out and became a consultant. And what I would do now is what I intended to do from the beginning, which was to try to do a fair, square program that had top qualified reporters and anchors, both minorities and women in prominent positions, and to do stories like what we did at Channel 7. We did, we won a Peabody for the Willowbrook series. But the Peabody wasn't as important as the fact that we changed the way mentally challenged people are treated in this country forevermore. That was a very big thing in my life and in Geraldo's life. And when I was at ABC, you know, I would go over there to the network and, you know, they have crews all over the country, all over the world. And there's stuff that's coming in constantly. It never sees the air. And I would do more international news. I try to cover the world a little better than it's being covered.
Al Primo, you embody the word leader. In your experience, what makes a good leader, especially in a newsroom? What qualities are essential?
Well, you know, people, you know, have to trust in you. And, you know, when you're the leader of the newsroom, you know, you're part of management, and just naturally, you know, there's a dividing line. You know, you're management and they're employees, and you somehow have to transmit the aura and the feeling that, you know, you're fair, you're decent, you know, you have the best interests of all of us, not just your own. And that's easy to say and harder to do because, you know, we're all human beings. You know, the first thing that happened when we got Eyewitness News established, they get a call from the New York Times. The guy says, I'd like to come over and interview you about this. And I said, well, you know, I'm the news director here. What did you want to know? He said, well, you know, tell me about the concept and all the rest of it. And I thought, well, geez, this is different. A newsman interviewing another newsman. And so that was kind of an indication that, like, we must be making an impact here. Somebody's noticing what we're doing. And they did a story, a little blurb about Eyewitness News in New York and so forth. And During that interview, I made it a point to talk about how we were trying to reflect the community, that we wanted the people in the newsroom to be part of the community. And I can tell you to this day, you know, when we went out and covered disturbances or strikes, no one ever hurt our cars or no one ever turned our vehicles over. And in many cases, many cases, doing riots and things like that, you know, they helped us out, you know, and they got us out of the danger zone. And so that was an indication of the, you know, the audience trusted in you. And those little things register, you know, with the people that work in the, you know, in the building. So if you want to be a leader, you know, you got to really be concerned about not yourself, but, you know, the whole package, the whole thing. And the newsroom, you know, wants you to be, you know, on top of things. You know, you got to be at work. You got to be on time. You got to be in the newsroom. You got to walk around. You got to care. You got to, you know, when somebody does a good job, you got to tell them. When somebody does a bad job, you got to tell them, but you got to tell them in a way that they don't feel picked upon or discriminated against. And, you know, that's a very difficult thing to do nowadays. You know, you're dealing with, you know, people that aren't, have not worked up the news ranks to get to where you are, you know, because, you know, you learn a lot being in those small stations, working your way up, you know, being disappointed, being taken advantage of. You know how to deal with all those things. So that's all part of leadership. It's very important to do that. Very, very important.
We'll be back with Al Primo and more on The Story.
If you've enjoyed watching the story of Princess Diana on The Crown on Netflix, then you will love Princess Diana the Musical by singer-composer Karen Sokolov-Chavich.
Long before Diana became a princess, she was Lady Diana Spencer, a descendant of King Charles II of England.
It will make you laugh.
She's a star.
She's a star.
She's a star.
She's a star.
We never expected this enormous star.
Cry.
I need help, please. I can't do this all alone.
And remember, an extraordinary woman who left us far too soon. Get the soundtrack Princess Diana the Musical, available now on Apple Music, Google Music, and at princessdianathemusical.com. And for a limited time, you can download a copy of the script of Princess Diana the Musical absolutely free, courtesy of Hoyer Publishing. Just go to princessdianathemusical.com. Get the soundtrack now.
We're back with Al Primo on more on The Story. Al, you created a legacy at Eyewitness News, and you created a family at Eyewitness News. So many people in the business today admire you and what you've accomplished. And I want to know, who in broadcast journalism do you admire and why?
Well, who do I admire? I always like more like of the networks, and you know, I always had a fascination for ABC, NBC, CBS. You know, these are gigantic organizations, and I admire what they're doing. You know, when it started out, the networks, you know, were supposedly to not make money but really serve the community, and of course, it's turned out to be the news has become the biggest money revenue generator, you know, for these companies. And, you know, I have a great deal of respect for, you know, the people that are dealing with that these days. So
there's a push-pull. You know, we're journalists, but the guys upstairs are businessmen. Did you ever have any incidents, altercations where your journalistic side said, let's do this, and they said, uh-uh?
All the time. Remember, you know, poor Melba came to work with her hair from... Melba went from looking like Diane Carroll to Angela Davis one night, you know, and it's like, can you imagine what I was going through when there came down, they thundered down from the top, you know, it was like, hey, so just getting through that was an achievement, believe me.
Well, achievements, you certainly had many, many, many of them, and we are grateful to you, both as journalists and as viewers. thank you so, so very much for being with us today. Oh, it was fascinating.
It's been an honor to be on your program. And, you know, that's the new media. You know, people are listening to these podcasts, and that's a great thing. You know, I think anytime you can reach the audience with good information, I think it's great.
Every business has its icons, pioneers who have big ideas and make them happen. In the world of television news, Albert T. Primo is one of those icons. His concept, Eyewitness News, changed the face of local newscasts. His revolutionary vision succeeded on every level. He hired reporters and anchors who truly reflected the community, opening the door for women and minorities who had been shut out. He created stylistic innovations that showcased the headlines. And most importantly, his news teams got it first and got it right, earning awards, raising ratings, and raising revenue. Despite enormous pressure that's endemic to every newsroom on deadline, Al Primo created a family, and he made it fun, never losing sight of the awesome responsibility to deliver fair and accurate reports. Decades after he left ABC, his legacy lives on in the hearts and minds of his colleagues and in the newscasts he created. For more on the story, I'm Judith Bishop.